down on my knees again, surrendering all, surrendering all. Find me here, Lord, as you draw me near, just before you. I'm dead before you. I surrender. Dress my soul, mercy and grace. Speak to me now. I surrender.
Like a rock. Thank you, Jesus.
If I can just take this moment to say something, I would like to wish my beautiful wife a happy birthday and a happy anniversary. Yeah. 18 years.
Valley, yes, I will bless your name.
same God that never fails. Won't fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. Same God who's never late, working all things out. Working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy.
Jesus.
Tried to get her a new house for her birthday, but I missed by a week, I think.
Ooh.
Fail.
Marshall.
Standing on this mountain top, looking just how far we've come, knowing every step you make, you will win. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory you're found in. Scars and struggles on can say, yes, our hearts can say, never once did we ever walk alone, never once did you leave us on our own, you are faithful, God, you are faithful.
thank you, God, for being so faithful, right? Never leaves us alone, even when we feel like it, right?
Taken by the wonder of you, here inside your glory, give our lives fully to you. Here inside your presence, taken by the wonders of you. Oh,
you, Jesus. Lord, I just thank you so much for this time, Lord, and just praising you, Lord, for everything you've done in our lives. Lord, I just thank you so much for what you've done in my life, Lord. Just pull me back from the brink of death and just everything that went along with that. I just pray that this morning that everyone here knows the love that you have for them, Lord, and just even when we feel like we don't deserve it, you give it to us anyway, Lord. I just praise you for everything you're doing in our lives, Lord. And I just pray for Aaron as he prepares to give the message, Lord, that your words be his words, Lord, and just that we have open ears to listen and open hearts to receive what he has for us. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, no doubt.
Buckle up and hold on. At our church, we love God. Make no mistake about that. At our church, we believe in God's radical, unconditional, and unwavering love for us. At our church, we believe that Jesus is God. We also affirm that you may or may not believe that Jesus is God. And we're not asking you to change your belief system before you attend our church. We're simply inviting you on a journey toward Jesus. For years, churches have placed a high priority on Jesus as the get-out-of-hell-free card. At our church, we place the highest priority on Jesus as a live life to the fullest invitation. At our church, we believe every person has a dream deep inside their hearts and that God put that dream there, not for our glory, but for His. At our church, we're not concerned with where you've been, but where you're going. At our church, we believe that the Bible is God's Word. It is real, it is living, it is active. We believe that people who don't go to church anywhere are not the enemy. They are real people who need the perfect love that only God can give. And we believe that God gives this love through, of all people, us. At our church, we do not and we will not display a holier-than-thou attitude toward anyone. We are all broken people, but He is putting us back together. And finally, and most importantly, at our church, we believe that Jesus really lived, that He really died on the cross, and that He really rose again on the third day. And we cannot and we will not candy coat or water down that message, ever. Today, you've chosen to sit yourself in the middle of a very safe place to hear a potentially dangerous message. Welcome to our church.
Welcome, everybody. Can you hear me? What? Maybe you don't have Verizon, right? I don't either. Praise God. Let me see. Gather my place here. Well, welcome everybody. My name is Aaron. I'm the associate pastor here at Freedom Biker Church in York, and I'm free. Amen. God is so good, man. Preacher Jim, he's out shooting pool in a pool league this weekend. Today, he should be back, I don't know when, maybe later on this evening. But if you come to church and your preacher's out shooting pool, you might just be at Freedom Biker Church. Amen. Amen. God is good. He loves to shoot pool, and he's shooting pool in the APA. And I think he's ranked 7. When I shot pool, I was like a 2 or 3. Jimmy's like a 6 or 7. He's a pretty good pool shooter. Amen. So, welcome to Freedom. So, we love to honor our veterans. Amen. We're going to do the Pledge to Allegiance. If everybody would like to stand. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. God is good, man. I'm thankful for our country. I'm thankful for our flag. I'm thankful for the men and women that died and paid the price for us to have the freedom that we have, to have a church like this. Chopper Church, you're dismissed. If anybody wants to send their children back to Sunday school, we call our Sunday school program here Chopper Church. September 28th, we're going to have a baptism out here. I believe that's September 28th. Vicki and Dave are going to get baptized. If there's anybody else that would like to get baptized out here, feel free to come on out and join us. It was, what's that? 29th, not the 28th. It's a Sunday, 29th, right? 28th is a Saturday. So come on out on the 29th for the baptism. It was another good weekend. Amen. John and Shauna got married yesterday. It was an awesome wedding. It was bike week here in York. We had a lot of people went out in town and hung out there for a while. A lot of people went down the hill climbs and hung out. It was just an awesome weekend altogether. On September 28th, there's a House of Hope is having a spaghetti dinner and a silent auction for a fundraiser. I think there's a flyer back there somewhere if you want to know more about that. Open Road Cafe on the fourth Saturday in October. And that's October 26th, 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. Also, the Sons of Thunder Men's Breakfast is starting back up the same day, the 4th. And that'll be out at the Old Country Buffet, 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. And if anybody's interested in that, they can see me or Josh. Josh is going to be heading that up again this year. Yep, Bo Miller riding. Right? Yep, that's on my list. Yep. Red Line Legion Riders Breakfast is starting back up the second Sunday in August, right? October. I got half fingers right the wrong day.
Close enough.
October. So next month, the Legion Riders Breakfast out over here in Red Line is starting back up. My mouth's watering right now. It's a good breakfast. The Bo Miller Ride is Saturday the 28th, and that's out at PR's. I think registration starts at 10 a.m. and kickstands up at noon. George, I think, has something he'd like to say for Cover 6 quick. Cover 6 canine.
You notice, Chant, my name didn't get a bunch of people involved. Morning, guys. A lot of you guys I see today are new here. Welcome to Freedom. Welcome to the family. My name is George. I'm the president of Cover 6 Canines, which started a little over 2 years ago with a dream that I had that I wanted to create an organization to provide dog and service dog training to not just veterans, but also first responders. And so that dream was hatched at Heritage Hills as me and Jimmy were smoking a cigar out on the patio before they told us we couldn't smoke out there. A few years fast forward, the program is going strong, and I'm proud to say, with the help of a lot of different individuals and volunteers, that we are now officially a 501c3 nonprofit. We just spent 10 days out at the fair, and the large majority of the volunteer hours out at the fair were done by handlers that also go to Freedom Biker Church. And I'd like to give a special applause to Phil in the back because he spent a ton of time there. So if you can get on I said canine stitch. Smart Alec. The big thing I want to put out there is we know we're losing 22 veterans a day. I think last year we lost just about 150 police officers to suicide, more than were killed in the line of duty. And we know we have fire, police, EMS, dispatchers that are suffering from PTSD and other ailments. So what we do, we want you to come back to your tribe. We want you to come back to those that signed on the dotted line. And one time or another, I'm going to go out there and put my life on the line for other people. If you, you're a vet or first responder or someone in your family is, and they're suffering from PTSD, or any kind of physical ailment, we do dogs for both. Please, before you leave today, stop in and see me, Phil, or my wife, Lisa. talk to us, and if you need a dog or somebody in your family a dog, you want to get you one, that's absolutely at no cost to you. So I appreciate everybody's support. Thank you. God bless.
Amen. Appreciate your heart, George, and everybody involved with that ministry and the effectiveness it's having in the community. And the men's breakfast, I got to say this before I forget. I think the women may be having a breakfast that same morning. Not 100% sure on that, but I believe that's their desire. So maybe see my wife about that. She didn't know that, but... see Rachel about that, and maybe I can get together. I heard some people talking about it. If you are interested in that, that'd be great. And also, Jane has a word she'd like to say about biker babes. I think this mic over here would be already Marshall's.
Good morning, Freedom Biker Church. How many biker babes do we have out there? Mark your calendars. Saturday, October 5th, I'm going to host a Biker Babes cookout at our place. We'll be providing hamburgers and hot dogs. We'll ask each one of you to bring a side dish or a dessert to share. It's just going to be a night of fellowship. We'll cook out on the fire. We'll just hang out by the campfire and just spend some quality time together for all ladies 18 and over. Hope you all can make it. I don't have flyers made yet. I will have them available next Sunday. Also, it should be on Facebook in the next day or two. So if you need the address or information or phone numbers to RSVP to, check that out. Or see me, see Bonnie in the back, or Jackie, or any of us. And hope to see you there. Thank you. Amen.
All right. So I'd like to thank everybody on the worship team for their dedication. I'd like to thank everybody back at the soundboard. Amen. Everybody that's been working the coffee bar and the hospitality, it's a blessing to have everybody pitch in like you do. The cleaning team, amen. Spent a lot of time in here. I think October 2nd, Refuel will be back here at the church currently. Amen. Currently, we've been meeting out at Quaker Steak and Lube, but that's coming to an end. And October 2nd, we'll be meeting back here for Bible study and prayer time and fellowship. We have Celebrate Recovery Friday nights here at the church, and that's a Christ-centered recovery program for any of your hurts, habits, or hang-ups. And you're welcome to join us there. We have a adult Bible school, Bible study, 8:30 to 9 a.m. And, of course, every Sunday we have church here. Hangout time starts at 9, and then church starts at 10:30. Amen. We're going to take offering. And just know that there's no membership fees here at Freedom. Whatever money you give, we're going to use for the kingdom of God. And we have a short video to watch during the offering. Word of God speak, amen. So I just want to open up real quick with a word of prayer. So Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for the breath of life you've given each and every one of us. And I just welcome the awareness of the Holy Spirit, Lord. I just give this whole message over to you. And I ask, Father God, that there just be an awareness of your presence here today. I pray that you would use me to deliver this message and the way you want it delivered. And Father, I thank you for just everything you've done and all the opportunities you've given each and every one of us. And we just give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. So today I want to talk a little bit about seed time and harvest and the incorruptible seed, the Word of God. And I just like to start with reading the verses, some of the verses that we're going to begin the message with. And Mark chapter 4, verse 13, and Jesus said, "And he said unto them, Know ye not this parable? And how then will ye know all parables?" In verse 14, he says, "The sower soweth the word." We're going to jump ahead a little bit to Mark 4, 26 through 28. And this is Jesus speaking again. And he said, "So is the kingdom of God, as if a man should cast seed into the ground, and should sleep and rise night and day, and the seed should spring and grow up, he knoweth not how. For the earth bringeth forth fruit of herself, first the blade, then the ear, after the full ear of, after that the full corn in the ear. But when the fruit is brought forth, immediately he putteth the sickle in the sickle, because the harvest is come." A few months ago, I was kind of struggling a little bit with why you see the Word of God working in some people's life, and possibly why it appears the Word of God's not working in other people's life. And I was praying about it, and I was asking the Lord what's going on. And this is kind of like the revelation of that to me. And I don't know if I'll be able to expound to use the way that it kind of became alive to me. But I put together some illustrations like to try to go through and hopefully not spill it and get a mess over everything. But I think there comes a time in our lives where we got to just really start to value the Word of God and believe it as the absolute truth, no matter what the rest of the world is saying. And just stand on it and meditate on it, and just really let it come alive in our hearts. And Mark, I want to try to pull the key points I believe that Jesus was trying to make as he was going through these verses. And in Mark 4:13, Jesus says, "And he said unto them, Know ye not this parable? And how then will you know all parables?" So I think what Jesus was trying to do here was he was trying to drive home the point that if you don't understand the principles that I'm teaching in this parable, you're not going to understand the principles that I'm teaching in the rest of the parables. So I believe that this parable is pretty important to try to understand. I think that it's one of the keys to unlocking the power of the kingdom in our lives. And I think he wants to drive that point home to him. In Mark 4, chapter 4, verse 14, Jesus says, "The sower soweth the word." So as we go through these scriptures, you're going to see that the sower, Jesus is referring to the sower, he's comparing a seed with the Word of God. Amen. He's trying to get us to see that the principles that God has installed are the law of seed time and harvest. A lot of us understand that in the natural, but we really kind of don't understand the spiritual. So I want to try to give a couple of illustrations and a couple scriptures to try to help solidify that in our lives and help us just understand that, how the principles, a lot of times in nature, God has established things that also is representative in the spiritual. So this is one of the, so in verse 28, chapter 4, verse 28, he says that the earth bring forth fruit of herself, first the blade, then the ear, after that the full corn in the ear. These words that he used here for bring forth fruit of herself. Fruit of herself is the word, if you go through in the Greek, it's the word we get automatic from. It's self-moved. It's spontaneous. It happens of its own accord. Verse 27 says, and should sleep and rise night and day, and the seed should spring and grow up, he knoweth not how. So he's referring to the guy that plants the seed, right? He goes to sleep, he gets up, he goes to sleep, he gets up, and one day there's a harvest from that seed. And he doesn't know how. He doesn't know how that seed actually works. He just knows the law. And when you plant the seed, after a period of time, you're going to have a harvest. So Jesus is trying to drive home this teaching, this law that's been established by God in the spiritual as well. And to illustrate some of the things that just kind of hit me while I was reading this and meditating on it, here I have a cup of soil, right? And I got a little seed corn. This ain't actually seed corn. It's a piece of Scotty's popcorn. I couldn't get a seed a kernel in time. It might work. I don't know. But, hey, we're going to plant this seed, right? And we all have, a lot of us plant gardens, right? We go out and we work the soil and we plant the seed. And we go in, we sleep day, a couple days go by, a month or two, three, 4 months go by. And as that crop begins to grow, that kernel of corn turns into an ear of corn. And after that ear of corn develops, the full corn's in the ear, right? I don't have to understand how that works. I just have to plant the seed. I don't think man knows how it works, right? They got a seed. They can duplicate what a seed looks like. They can make something at the same size as a seed. They can make it look the same color. They can do all that. They can same weight. But they can't get it to generate like a seed does, right? When you plant that seed in the ground, that seed takes what it needs out of the ground and becomes whatever God predestined that seed to be, right? It could be an acorn, right? There's not an acorn. There's not a tree inside this acorn. But when you plant it, it draws out of the ground what it needs to become a tree. And we don't understand how that seed works. I don't think science, they can get a pretty good feel of what they need to do to help that seed grow, but they don't fully understand how that seed becomes an oak tree. So what we got here is we got a seed that's planted in the soil, right? And that seed represents the Word of God being planted in your heart, right? The soil represents your heart, represents your mind, your will, and And that seed represents the Word of God being planted in that. So what's happening, I believe, is people are coming to church, people are coming to CR, and they're going and they're listening to the Word of God on the radio, they're reading their Word of God, they're reading the Bible, and they're getting seed, right? You're hearing the Word being preached, and you feel the power of the Word of God, right? You get hope that there's a chance that you're going to be free from whatever addiction you're wrestling with, right? You feel the Holy Spirit bring that revelation to you, right? I don't care what it is that you're wrestling with, whether it's oppression, depression, drugs, alcohol, immorality, whatever you're wrestling with. You hear the Word of God being preached, and you feel the truth of it, and that hope sparks, that seed starts to sprout up. And then what we do is we go out into the world, right? Some of us go to more places than Christ-centered recovery groups or churches. This represents Christian fellowship, right? This green cup may represent work. This one may represent a secular recovery program. But what happens is we plant the Word of God gets planted in our hearts here at church or Christ-centered places, and what we do is we dig that seed back up when we go to work, and we plant it over here, and we hear all the secular philosophies, our work buddies telling us what they think and how they feel and their experiences that aren't working, right? And then we leave there, and then we go to a secular program, we dig that seed back up, come over here, and we listen to everything they have to say and tell us how there's no hope. Once you're an addict, you're always an addict, and you just have to learn how to cope with it and manage your whatever you're struggling with, your depression or whatever it is. Because they don't have the power of God, they're telling you how you just got to learn how to deal with it, right? They want to put you on more drugs to suppress your feelings or your habits, right? So what happens, think about it, when you have a seed and you plant it in the garden, and if you go out every day and you dig it up and keep it out for about 12 hours, go to bed and get up in the morning, dig it out, carry it around all day, go back home, plant it again, what's going to happen to that seed? It's not going to grow, right? It's going to die. It may start to sprout, but eventually it's going to die because it's not staying nurtured in the Word of God, right? It's not staying in good soil. You keep taking it out and going over here. And most of what they're teaching over here doesn't line up with what the Word of God says. So we take it out and put it over here, right? So I think that's what's happening in a lot of our lives, right? We get the Word of God planted in our hearts. Freedom, we taste the revelation of truth, and we go out here, and we go home, and we sit in front of the TV, and we hear every liberal thing that the liberal media wants to throw at us, right? We feel like, oh, I need to be in a meeting every day, right? So we'll run to another meeting that has secular teachings. And everything that we learned here gets chiseled at because they're teaching something totally different. Or maybe we don't go to a secular program. Maybe we just go to work and we start sharing our week with other people and they start giving their worldly opinion, right? That starts chiseling away. So what I believe Jesus is saying here is that, and as we go through some other scriptures, is the Word of God being planted in your heart, you got to keep it. You got to meditate on it. You got to keep your eyes on it. You can't feed your soul the Word of God and then run over here and feed it with this and then run over here and feed it with that. It gets everything mixed up, gets like weeds throughout the roots, and it can't grow properly. And the next thing you know, you're not walking in victory because you're being torn in all these different directions. What we got to learn to hear these other things, that the Apostle Paul says that we're supposed to cast down vain imagination. And vain imagination is everything that opposes the truth of the Word of God. So anything that you read or hear in the Word of God is absolute truth. Anything that doesn't line up with that is not the truth, and we need to cast it down. Amen. It's when we start entertaining the other teachings and philosophies of the world is when we don't get our victory, right? You hear it all the time, well, I'm only human, right? We're not only human. We're made of spirit, soul, and body, right? One third of us is spirit. And when you become born again, you receive the Holy Spirit. So one third of you is Holy Spirit, right? And you need to feed the Holy Spirit inside you. You need to feed your spirit, man, with the word of truth so you can grow and walk in these things and not let it get tainted with the things of the world. Amen. And we can do that. We can feed. So we need to start replacing our time, right, with Christ-centeredness. Come to church, hear the word, right? Go somewhere else that people are giving godly counsel. Listen to that. May need to change our friends, a couple of friends, right? The people that we're getting counsel off of, we may not be able to go to them for counsel anymore. We may have to find some new people to call and talk to and pray with. We may need to change the other programs that we're going to if they're not Christ-centered. If they continue to oppose the Word of God, we need to try to line up everything that we're taking counsel in with the Word of God, and that may come down to changing TV shows we watch. It may come down to changing some of the music we listen to, but I think that's the thing. We need to keep our eyes focused on the Word of God. Amen. So in John 8:36 through 37, Jesus says this. He says, "If the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed." Amen. Jesus ain't a liar, is he? Nope. He said, "If I make you free, you're going to be free indeed." And we even got it painted on the wall back there. Amen. That's how much we believe what Jesus says. Verse 37 says, "I know that ye are Abraham's seed, but ye seek to kill me because my word hath no place in you." Amen. So, listen, we need to come to a place where we're giving his word a place in us, right? They weren't, these people he was talking to was not receiving him because they weren't allowing the word to settle in them. They were rejecting him. We need to receive what he says. We need to dwell on it. We need to meditate on it. We need to pray about it. We need to get into the Word of God and read it. If sometimes you have a hard time reading, they got audio CDs we can listen to with that. The New Testament on audio CDs, we can listen to it on our phone, but we need to submerge ourselves with the Word of God, the truths of the Word of God. Do I have a slide there? Yep. So, we got to plant the seed, right? We need to give the seed time to grow. Amen. Sometimes people are always trying to rush the harvest, right? We try to rush the harvest. Like, we get saved, we're on fire, we're new Christians, and we want to run out and change the world, right? And we don't take the time to allow the seed of the Word of God to grow in our hearts and become something before we rush out into the world and try to change it. And there's nothing wrong with that. We want to get out there. We want to share Christ with people, but we got to come to a place where we allow the harvest to come, right? We got to grow in Christ. And the other fault is that I had, too, was like Evelyn and Ken have a garden down at their house. And the other week, me and Evelyn and Ken, me and my wife were down there visiting them. And garden, right? And everything they planted in their garden was growing there. Now, the interesting thing is when you go over to someone's house and look at their garden, they really don't have to tell you what they planted, right? You can see what they planted because it naturally grows there. If something's growing in that garden, even if they didn't plant it, somebody planted it, right? Maybe a neighbor came over and planted it. Maybe a bird dropped a seed. But there's something growing there because it was planted, right? So even if you didn't want it planted there, it may be growing there, right? Because it could have been a neighbor, it could have been a bird. And a lot of times we're wrestling with these different things because of seeds that have been planted in our lives, and we didn't want them planted there. We didn't invite them to be planted there, but somehow they got planted there, and they're affecting our lives. And we need to use the Word of God to uproot them things, right? And allow the Holy Spirit to minister to us and remove them things. Take the things in the garden in our hearts that don't belong there and get rid of them. Amen. In Romans 12, 1 through 2, the Apostle Paul says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable act of service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove that which is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. The word transforming, right? Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. That's another seed time and harvest thing, right? It's a renewing process. It doesn't happen instantly. Sometimes it takes a while. And sometimes our mind gets renewed quicker in some areas than it does other areas, right? So you may have victory right now on this subject, but it may take a little longer to have it in this subject. But don't give up. Right? Keep meditating on the Word of God and that victory will come. And this verse, this Romans 6, 11 through 14, this is the verse that I experienced victory from, meditating on this verse. And that's one of the reasons why I wanted to share it with you. I was so excited to get free after meditating and reading this verse, that I actually made this t-shirt years ago. One of them iron transfers. You print them out on your computer. But it says, he that the Son sets free is free indeed. And it's got like three crosses there, and it says, be set free in Jesus. Amen. And then on the back it has, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world gives to you. Let not your heart be troubled, nor let it be fearful. Amen. But Romans 6, 11 through 14, likewise, renounce, count, which means count, ye also yourself to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it the lust therefore. Neither yield ye your members as instruments as unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourself unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. For sin shall have no dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. That scripture just became alive to me. The moment that came alive to me, I meditated on Romans chapter 6 for probably 2 weeks, studying that out, and when that thing clicked like that, I got free. A lot of stuff just dropped off. And I'm not saying that I'm perfect, that I don't make mistakes, but the actual bondage left. Amen. And when this started becoming a reality to me, I didn't see that before, right? I didn't see that it was meditating on the Word of God that triggered my freedom, but now I see it. And I think that's what the one of the things Jesus was trying to drive home is, if he did die. He died to set us free from the bondage of sin, but we need to keep our eyes on the Word of God. We need to keep our eyes in it, and we need to let that come alive in our hearts. In Romans chapter 8, verse 6, the scripture says, "For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace." Now the word carnally, that word, right, is not sin, right? The word carnal there is not sin, but all sin is carnal, right? So sin is carnal, but to be carnally minded is just naturally minded, right? Just how the world thinks, right? If your mind is naturally focused on the way the rest of the world thinks, it's going to bring forth death, right? But to be spiritually minded, the scripture says, is life and peace. Amen. I worked with a guy years ago. He told me he was taking Xanax. I asked him why he's taking Xanax. He said because he has anger issues, right? So he pops a Xanax every time he gets angry to help calm him down. And I just simply said to him, you know, brother, if you would sit down and read a proverb instead of popping a Xanax, your anger would probably go away, right? And he looked at me and he said, you know, you're probably right, you know. But the world is so quick, they just want to pop a pill. For some reason, we'll spend hundreds of dollars to pop pills or to do drugs or drink to try to drown our sorrows and drown our anxiety and things that we're dealing with, but we won't take the time to meditate on the Word of God. And sometimes it's that simple. We just got to get in the Word of God and meditate on what it says and believe it. And those things disappear. They leave. They can't stand in the presence of God. We sing all kinds of songs about it, right? Fear is a liar, right? Victory is mine. The chains are broken, right? Why doesn't it seem to work in some people's lives? Is because we're not meditating on the Word of God. And that's what we got to do. In John 6:36, scripture says, "It is the Spirit that quickeneth," which means to make come alive, right? "The flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak to you, they are spirit and they are life," right? So to be spiritually minded is to be word minded. If you plant the seed of the Word of God in your heart, then your life will bring forth life and it will bring forth peace. Proverbs 23:7, the scripture says, "For as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he." So are we planting truth in our hearts? Are we planting the Word of God? Are we planting fear? Failure? Are we thinking depression? Think thoughts about depresses? Are we thinking about things that depress us? Are we entertaining things that bring doubt into our hearts instead of confidence, no doubt, right? Are we thinking thoughts that addiction? Sometimes, I was thinking about this the other day too. The world has come to a place that everything is an addiction, right? The scripture flat out says things are sin, right? But we're quick to call it an addiction. Now, I'm not trying to say everything you're wrestling with is sin or an addiction. I'm not trying to make personal clarifications in your own lives. But the world calls things addictions because they don't have the power of Christ, right? The Bible calls it sin because the power of Christ can break any hold. We don't have to stay in bondage to it, right? So a lot of things that we're calling addictions and we're trying to pamper and get over is really sin. And we need to come to a place where we humble ourselves before God and say, yes, God, I'm living in sin. Forgive me of my sin. Place your faith and trust in Him and Him alone for one, for salvation. Starts placing your faith and trust in Jesus Christ as your personal Savior for the forgiveness of sin. He creates, you become a new creation at that point. He gives you a new spirit. Your spirit man becomes alive, filled with the Holy Spirit, and you begin to have the power to war against that kind of stuff. Walk against it, not stay in it. As you read the Word of God, it strengthens your spirit man. You begin to walk in victory. We need to stop filling ourselves with hopelessness. Are you filling yourself with the Word of God, filling yourself with victory, planting seeds of peace, planting seeds of love and joy, and planting seeds of a sound mind? We got to think about these things. Just step back and take a breath and look at it. Don't be quick to say that I tried the Jesus thing and it didn't work. Amen. Just try it right. 1 Peter 1:23 says, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible seed by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. Right? We're born again by an incorruptible seed. Proverbs 4:20-22. My son, attend to my words, incline thine ear unto my sayings, let them not depart from thine eyes, keep them in the midst of thine heart, for they are life unto those that find them, and health unto all their flesh. Psalms 107:20. He sent his word and healed them, and delivered them from their destructions. What did he send? He sent his word, right? And what did his word do? It healed them. It will heal you, right? It will deliver you from all your destructions. So God's word will deliver you from whatever your oppression is. Amen. It'll even heal you, right? Sickness, disease, God can heal you. Joshua 1:8, the scripture says, this book of the law shall not depart out of thine mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night. Meditate in it day and night. That goes back to seed time, right? You plant the seed, you go to bed, you arise, you go to bed, you arise, you go to bed, you arise. Meditate on it day and night, right? That seed has to stay in good soil day and night for it to come alive, right? For it to bear fruit, so to say, if you will. Day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For when thou shalt make thy ways prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. So if you meditate on the Word of God, it's telling you that the Word of God will make your ways prosperous, right? You won't be stuck in failure and defeat. You'll be prosperous and you'll have good success in everything you do. I'd like to look quick here at, in closing, Mark chapter 4, verse 35. So Jesus, throughout the chapter of Mark chapter 4, throughout that day, Jesus had taught 13 parables that day. And he started off, before he taught them all, with seed time and harvest to try to get people lined up with and ready to receive everything else that he was getting ready to say. But at the end of the day, Mark chapter 4, verse 35, and a lot of people miss this. I never seen this before. I never even really heard it taught. So verse 35, and the same day when the eve was come, he saith unto them, let us pass over unto the other side. Now remember that Jesus spoke a word. He said, let us pass over unto the other side. That's a word from God. And they had sent away the multitude. They took him, even as he was in the ship, and there were also with him other little ships. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. So this boat, right, was starting to fill with water because the storm was so bad. And it wasn't a boat that had a cabin or anything. This was an open boat that they all were sitting in. And he, talking about Jesus, and he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. So Jesus, during the storm, he was getting wet, and he was just back there sleeping. And everybody else was in panic, right? They awake him and said unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? Now, isn't that something a lot of us say when you're fighting oppression or depression or some type of addiction? Lord, I thought you said that I'm free from this. Don't you care? You know, when I got set free from the nicotine addiction, I said, Lord, either your word's true or it's not. Either you set me free from this or you didn't, right? But I had to stand on that word, right? I got hit with a nicotine rush, desire, and I had to stand on that, and I said, Lord, your word's either true or it's not true. Either I'm free of this or I'm not free of this, right? And that's when my freedom came. That's when I just, bam, I got set free from that. And I haven't desired that to smoke since that point, right? But this is what they said to the Lord. Carest thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, peace be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, why are you so fearful? Right? You know why they were so fearful? Huh? The storm shifted their sight, right? Jesus gave them a word in the beginning. He said, let's go to the other side. And on their way over, they got hit with a storm, right? And their whole focus shifted off of the word and started to focus on everything going on around them, and they started to get fearful. They started to doubt. And they feared exceedingly and said one to another, what manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? They missed it. They spent all day with Jesus teaching the parables. He told them in the beginning of that day, he said, "You seed time and harvest. Plant the seed, it grows, and then the harvest comes," right? He was in the ship with them physically, right? And they didn't grasp the word that he gave before they pushed off. He said, let's go inside. They lost their faith that Jesus was going to see them through to the other side. They would have made it. There's the other thing, too, is they had the word of God to stand on and not dwell and stay in that fear. They could have called it back up. Now, wait a minute. The Lord said, we're going to the other side. This fear, this storm's not going to stop me. I'm not dying out here in the sea. The Lord said, we're going the other side, and I'm believing we're getting to the other side, right? We got to get that mentality. We can't let the storms of life going on around us, whether it's the social media, whether it's the TV, whether it's the talk radio. Let these things steal the seed of the Word of God out of our heart. We got to keep our eyes focused on what the Word of God says and believe that if He says, I'm going to the other side, I'm going to the other side. I don't care how rough it feels, right? If he says, I don't have to struggle, I don't have to be in bondage to sin, then freedom's coming. I don't have to be in bondage to this. The world says, you're going to have to deal with it to the day you die, and here, we'll help you, give you some pills to help take that desire away, or we'll try to help counsel you to get you through, but you're just going to have to learn to deal with that. Jesus says, no, I've taken it away. You don't have to stay like that. You can walk into freedom, right? We got to keep our eyes on Jesus in the midst of this storm. And if you do that and you allow the Word of God time, right, to grow in your heart, you're going to experience that freedom. Amen. God cannot lie. Amen. He can't lie. Jesus is not a liar. The Word of God is absolutely true. And if we stand on these principles, fear, it has to leave, right? Oppression, depression cannot stand against the Word of God. Amen. Neither can what the world calls your addiction. Amen. So if there's anybody here today that has never placed their faith and trust in Jesus Christ, I'd like to encourage you to do so. That's really where it all begins, is placing your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. And it's as simple as this. It's not a bunch of works, right? Religion is set up that you have to work your way somehow to earn favor, to someday that God's just so pleased with your efforts that he lets you into heaven. That's not true, right? The scripture says that salvation is a gift. It's a free gift. You can't work for it. You can't earn it. You don't even deserve it, right? Jesus Christ died to pay for that gift, to give you a place in heaven, to take away your sin, and to free you from the bondage of sin. And all you have to do is confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ died on the cross, that he was buried, he rose again victoriously over sin and death. Amen. He didn't stay in the grave. He beat sin and death and came back to life. God was completely satisfied with the payment that he made on your sin debt. And all you have to do is place your faith and trust in him and him alone to save you, right? When I die and go to heaven, and God, he's not going to say this because he's already going to know, but if he would say, Aaron, why should I let you into my heaven? And I said, well, I went to church every Sunday. I helped down on the at the mission on Saturdays. Then I'm trying to earn God's favor, right? Doesn't work like that. Islam, Hinduism, all that stuff. All the isms is a works-based religion. Christianity is not. Christianity, other religions, you do something to please God, to try to earn your way to heaven. Christianity, God did something for you, amen, because he loves you. He paid a debt you could never pay, and he wrote your name in the Lamb's Book of Life the minute that you placed your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. So I want to encourage you to do that today. Place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, and it can be as simple as this. To say, Father, forgive me of all my sin, and I believe that Jesus, you died on the cross for my sins, that you rose again victoriously from the grave, and I receive you as my Savior. I place my faith and trust in you and you alone as my Savior. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for dying for me. And help me be the person you created me to be. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. If that is the first time you ever did that in your life, I want to encourage you. Welcome to the family of God. You become born into a family. And I want you to think about this. You have a mom and you have a dad here on earth, right? They were always your mom and dad. They'll always be your mom and dad. Even if they passed away, they were always your mom and dad, right? It didn't matter what that relationship was like. They were still your parents. And the moment you place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, you become born into the family of God. And God is your spiritual father now. And Your relationship with God may seem to change here and there, but he'll always be your father, right? You'll always be his child born into his family. Be encouraged with that. It's not something that can change, right? The relationship may change from time to time because of the way you're acting, but he'll always be your father. Amen. Just don't lose hope. Amen.
That's truth there, right? All right, let's all stand up. And turn these bright lights down, somebody. Praise God. Have a great